After a very long wait of decades and a very successful deployment, the James Webb Space Telescope has delivered its first science and its mission that will last at least a decade. The first images were beyond spectacular, and while they were in some ways intended to kick the tires and show the telescope off, discoveries and mysteries were nonetheless revealed in these initial images. The first major discovery involves the Southern Ring Nebula, or NGC 3132. This is known as a planetary nebula. When you look at this image, you are seeing the future of the Sun and our solar system. This somewhat misnamed type of nebula has nothing to do with planets per se. Rather, in the early days of astronomy, it was noted that these kinds of nebulae resembled planets in early telescopes, but did not move like planets. But the name stuck. What actually happens here is that at the end of a 1 to 8 solar mass red giant star's life, it sheds its atmosphere and becomes ionized and essentially lit up. The phase is short-lived for a star, only a few tens of thousands of years, but we see examples just because of the sheer amount of stars in the Milky Way, over 100 billion. NGC 3132 lies at a distance of about 2,500 light-years, and has been found by Webb to actually have a double star system at its core. It's interesting because both stars are capable of producing planetary nebulae. The dimmer star is the one producing the currently seen nebula, and itself is at the white dwarf stage of stellar evolution. The other star in the system isn't to that stage yet, it's in an earlier stage. So in the future, long after the current nebula has dissipated, a second shell of dust and gas will form in the system and persist for a few thousand years, sort of like a delayed second burst in a fireworks display. Using JWST's mid-infrared instrument and its near-infrared camera, characterization of this nebula shows intricate patterns in the dust and gas that show the interplay of the two closely orbiting stars. If you could see this system from another angle, it would look something like this image. But since we see it at a sort of sideways perspective, for lack of a better term, we see it as a planetary nebula. You can actually reconstruct the history of the star system by patterns in the nebula, and how close they are from the pair of stars. Other features are where light from the binary system forms strong rays flowing through gaps in the gas and dust shell. This overall allows astronomers to study stellar evolution at a late stage, and how planetary nebulae such as this enrich the interstellar medium with materials that could someday be incorporated into new planets, perhaps even one similar to Earth, but also give insight into what our solar system might be like during the late stages of the Sun's future red giant phase. Perhaps Earth, if it survives, may one day lie within a planetary nebula like NGC 3132. The next image is intended to be an eye-popper. This is the Carina Nebula, which can be called a stellar nursery. This is where stars are typically born. Gigantic nebulae like this spawn stars across the universe. With a much higher resolution of James Webb over that of previous space telescopes, scientists will be able to gain insight on star formation, especially studying fine details of these many light years wide clouds of gas and dust. Within the Carina Nebula, there are very hot young stars forming gaseous cavities within the nebula that ultimately determine the outer features we see, known as cosmic cliffs, allowing astronomers a kind of probe of the interior of the nebula. And the effect of the hot ultraviolet light streaming off the stars helping to sculpt and even dissipate the nebula itself. Interestingly, this is something we really couldn't do with Hubble. Before we get to that, it's interesting to compare the resolution of Hubble with a much larger JWST. The gain in resolution and light collection is quite clear, but given that Webb is a predominantly infrared telescope, it can reveal things and probe differently than visible light telescopes can do, gaining insight on objects in visible light that are obscured by dust. You can even see protostellar jets in this image, which stream out from young stars in this situation. This is also an evolutionary process. Once you have a star inside a nebula like this, the motion of the dust and gas as a result of the presence and radiation of the star can trigger further collapses in the nebula to form even more stars. Eventually, though, so much material is blown out that star formation ceases. Webb provides significant insight into this process of evolution in great detail, including potentially answering questions about how many stars form in a certain region under these conditions, and what governs their masses. As an aside, the Carina Nebula is home to one of the strangest stars we've ever seen in the Milky Way. It's Eta Carinae, and it's a ridiculously unstable and active supergiant star. It's at least a binary star system. There are at least two stars involved, maybe more, that together are 5 million times more luminous than the Sun. This system has dramatically brightened in the past, flaring up in 1837 and 1843, only to fade out of naked eye visibility a little over a decade later. It flared again at the end of the 19th century, dimmed, and then began a sustained brightening around 1940 that continues to this day. This star is set to go supernova in the relatively near geologic future, and oddly enough, emits one of the few known natural laser beams in nature, in ultraviolet, from its position nestled in the Homunculus Nebula, a shell of gas it emitted in the past, that forms a kind of nebula within a nebula. To show a wide range of observations, the next is of particular interest. Webb had been able to make long-term observations of an exoplanet, WASP-96b. This was actually a surprise. This exoplanet, actually termed a hot Saturn, though it differs very much from our gas giants, orbits a G-type star just over 1,000 light-years away. This planet was chosen because it presents easy observation, frequently passing in front of its host star, allowing for relatively rapid-fire observations from which to get good spectra on the order of one pass every 3.5 days, resulting in Webb being able to collect 280 individual spectra in a relatively short period of time. It also has a significantly extended atmosphere, helping for easy observation. Previously, this planet was shown to have a strong signature of sodium, which at the time led to a model of a gas giant with no upper cloud deck. Webb has shown this not to be the case, with a very strong, clear detection of water vapor in this exoplanet's atmosphere, and a corresponding likelihood of both clouds and haze. How these two observations will reconcile remains to be seen. It's worth noting here that WASP-96b is a gas giant and not a candidate for terrestrial life as we know it, but the detection of water vapor by Webb shows that it's capable of detecting atmospheric water profiles of exoplanets and will help in characterizing future exoplanets that may host biospheres. How this process works is surprisingly simple. Known as a transmission spectrum, you measure the host star's light as it passes through the atmosphere of the exoplanet during a transit. The gases present in the exoplanet's atmosphere then absorb wavelengths of light, giving telltale chemical signatures such as water vapor in the spectrum. The next image is of an interesting group of galaxies known as Stefan's Quintet. This is a visual cluster of five galaxies, though only four of the visible galaxies are actually close to each other and interacting. These galaxies are currently performing a dance that will ultimately result in their merger into an enormous resulting irregular galaxy. Interestingly, in the space between the galaxies where interactions are occurring, there is a radio source. Long unexplained, this radio source has turned out to be a shockwave moving through the intergalactic gas that's bigger than a galaxy, caused ultimately by one of the members moving into the center of the cluster at very high speed. One final image, the first released, is a deep field image, repeating the now famous Hubble Space Telescope's own deep field image. This one really shows off the work of Albert Einstein clearly with its very obvious display of gravitational lensing, with the gravity of the foreground objects bending the light of the galaxies behind them, distorting the image as we see it. This particular image, however, is turning out to be rather mysterious in that there are two features that are not yet readily explained. The first comes in the form of odd dots that do not appear to be stars in the image. These could be any number of things, even artifacts in the imaging, or extremely distant, dim stars or galaxies. The other is a rather odd gravitational lensing event that seems to present multiple images and can also be seen in the same image taken by Hubble years ago. It'll be interesting to find out what these objects are. But it does go to show that Webb's work is just beginning. But with such stunning images and capability, we can expect not only many more discoveries to add to the ones it accumulated at the first few weeks it could, but also reveal new mysteries in abundance about the universe, of which we still know very little. It's going to be an interesting run for JWST indeed, but there's one other notable incident regarding this telescope. While its launch, deployment, calibration, and mission commencement went effectively flawlessly, JWST did have one hiccup so far that simply couldn't be prevented. While it's designed to withstand micrometeoroid impacts, it is in space after all, it managed to get hit by a larger one than normal, which caused minor damage to one of the mirrors. But the damage was non-zero. NASA reported that they could measure a very tiny effect from the mirror damage in the data, but also noted that even after the impact, the telescope was still exceeding its design parameters, and the mission is in no danger. Hopefully, that doesn't happen too often from here on out. And there you have it, an update on the first science released by the JWST team, and stunning it is. I look forward to making many future updates about the discoveries the telescope makes, and the new mysteries it unveils about the universe. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about the well-being of JWST. Back in the day, I had a small rock put a non-zero chip in the LeBaron's windshield, and while it didn't affect anything, it does go to show that the universe just doesn't let us have nice things. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.